The honeybee Apis mellifera is the most important crop pollinator worldwide, contributing an estimated $600 billion to annual global crop value. Despite their importance as pollinators, the health of honeybees is declining, with the annual colony loss rate as high as 45% in the United States. The primary biological threat to honeybee health is the parasitic mite Varroa destructor, which I have covered many times in this channel. Varroa is both a physiological burden and a disease vector to its honeybee host. Numerous intervention methods exist to control Varroa mite, including chemical treatments such as synthetic miticides, organic acids, and essential oils, and mechanical techniques such as drone brood removal, brood interruption, and the use of Varroa-resistant honeybee stocks. The majority of beekeepers in the United States currently use synthetic miticides to control Varroa mites, despite evidence of negative sublethal effects and honey contamination. One promising avenue for achieving sustainable, effective Varroa control is the selective breeding of Varroa-resistant honeybees, meaning that we can breed better bees to fight Varroa themselves, without the need of any chemical in the hive. However, existing selection methods tend to trade efficacy for efficiency because the methods that achieve the highest level of Varroa-specific hygienic behavior are very time-consuming and demand great technical skills. It is a fact that nobody in the beekeeping industry wants to continue to use miticides or any other heavy chemicals inside the hive, and the selection of bees that can take care of themselves is a great goal for beekeepers. So what if we could develop a science-based way to select Varroa-sensitive hygiene without the demand for specialized, labor-intense techniques? Dr. Carol Wagner, a research scientist at the University of North Carolina in Greensboro, made a discovery that later would become a very interesting tool for beekeepers to select bees able to fight Varroa mite and the deformable virus by themselves. In her 2019 publication, she describes the discovery of specific molecules from Varroa-sensitive genetic stocks that serves as a bridge of communication between the infected pupa and the nurse that being triggered to remove the sick brood. Now researchers know the molecules sick pupa release that triggers nurse bees to remove them from the nest. With this new knowledge, Dr. Wagner and collaborators immediately jump into a new challenging project, the development of an assay where beekeepers can screen their own bees looking for ones able to fight Varroa and viruses by themselves. After several years of hard work and field trials in different locations, Dr. Wagner and collaborators developed the first ever Varroa-specific hygienic behavior evaluation system. Today, to find bees with high levels of hygienic behavior, we use a tedious method where we freeze brood and wait to see how many of these frozen pupa are removed from the hive. The freezing method worked like this. You go to the field with a tank full of liquid nitrogen, which is very dangerous to handle, by the way. And then you need to find a hive, open the hive, get a frame of brood with capped brood that we have enough space to do the test. Then you use a PVC tube that you fill it up with liquid nitrogen so you can kill a very specific area of the capped brood. And then you put it back everything, close the hive, and go back after a couple days to count how many of this dead brood was removed from that frame. And with that number in mind, you do some calculations to do an estimation about how, the level of hygienic behavior that specific colony has. It is not a bad way to do it. However, it is not specific. The molecules activating hygienic behavior that are molecules being released from dead brood by freezing. That's all. It doesn't help us to understand better the biology behind it so we can improve it. The new way Dr. Wagner developed, we go to the hive with a simple spray bottom containing a harmless solution and perform the same procedure as the freezing method. You find the hive, you find capped brood, then instead of using liquid nitrogen, you just spray the new compounds on the top of the capped brood and wait for 2 hours to count how many of these brood were uncapped. This is another good part of the procedure. Because the brood is not really dead, hygienic bees will open the capped brood to evaluate the situation and then they end up not removing them. Meaning that you also don't need to kill the bees for this new procedure, which is always welcome in honeybee research. The main question now is, does it work? How does it compare with the traditional method of freezing? How does it correlate with varroa levels? Will it be useful for beekeepers to select genetic stocks? The data shows that the new assay that she called UBO, unhealthy brood odor, was negatively correlated with varroa infestation levels, meaning the higher bees respond to the spray compounds, the lower the varroa mite infestation in real-life situations in the field. The results could be repeated in two different months, June and August. Dr. Wagner also tested the traditional method, FKB, freezing killed brood, on the same hives to compare. The freezing test also negatively correlates with varroa infestation levels. However, the correlation could not be repeated on both months tested. Another result that got my attention when you compare the two methods was that the colonies with the high response to the new method showed a varroa mite infestation level below the recommended level to treat for varroa, meaning that if the data is correct, beekeepers will be able to select colonies that will require none or very little varroa treatment. Results like this are very encouraging because it not only gives us a new tool to help honeybees to fight varroa mites, but also open research opportunities for us to understand hygienic behavior better. The article is full of other interesting experiments, and I'll leave a link in the description of this video if you want to check it out. Or if you are a patron of this channel, I publish a 20-minute presentation going over all the results about this article. Check it out. I invited Dr. Kara Wagner to join me in a live stream to discuss her findings. The live stream is scheduled for Sunday, December 19 at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. It is free to everyone, and I will leave a link in the description of this video so you can register to receive more information. Is hygienic behavior good or bad for honeybees? Please take a look at this footage. These, at the center of the screen, are hygienic bees doing their job. What you're about to see is what really happened in real time. They're removing a sick brood, and in doing so, they consume part of them. Cannibalism, as I mentioned in another video in this channel. If you follow this channel for a while, you know why I'm bringing this footage for you today. In previous video, I covered that hygienic behavior are able to spread viruses. So there is that question in the air that we might need to address. Is hygienic behavior good or bad to honeybees? In previous video, I showed that there is a chance that maybe hygienic behavior might be hurting the bees. Now in this video, I brought Dr. Kara showing that hygienic behavior might be good for honeybees against varroa mite and viruses itself. So what's the point of me bringing these two apparently conflicting results? It's just to illustrate how science really works. I talk with a lot of beekeepers when I visit them, and people sometimes are skeptical about science. And what I realize is that people don't know what science is or how science works. In a scientific community, we are looking for new data all the time. We are experimenting all the time. And with time, science corrects itself. We have different groups working in different approaches and different methodologies. And with time and everybody checking each other's work, we come up with the best experiment, with the best demonstration. And that's how things work. The real truth comes from years of studies and people questioning each other and doing more experiment and repeating the experiment in different locations with different people. That is when we really establish new truth or new knowledge scientifically demonstrated. So we're going to discuss this with Dr. Kara on Sunday. I want to invite everybody to join us live on Sunday, December 19 at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. So we're going to discuss this subject about is hygienic behavior good or bad for honeybees. So I hope you enjoy. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys Sunday or in my next video, InsideTheHive.tv, the show about bees. See you guys next time.